يا سيدي ويا مولاي يا أبا عبد الله، يا رحمة الله الواسعة ويا باب نجاة الأمة، ما خاب من تمسك بكم، أمنا من لجأ إليكم. يا ليتنا كنا معكم فنفوز فوزا عظيما. صلوا على محمد وآل محمد. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، الحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن سيدنا وعظيمنا وحبيب قلوبنا النبي المؤيد والرسول المسدد والمصطفى الأمجد والمحمود الأحمد حبيب إله العالمين أبي القاسم محمد. صلوات الله وسلامه عليه وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المظلومين، سفن النجاة الأعلام، من ركب سفينتهم نجا ومن تخلف عنها هلك وغرق. ثم أما بعد، my respected scholars, brothers and sisters, elders, السلام عليكم جميعا ورحمة الله وبركاته. As you can recall from yesterday that we stopped at the beginning of the seven veils that I was speaking about earlier in my introduction to the topic of today. So there are seven veils, I said, in order for us to be able to be in a position to reach Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to connect with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we need to get rid of these seven veils that sometimes consciously, subconsciously, whatever the case may be, we develop them in our life, in our living, whatever the case may be, we need to learn how to get rid of them. Because without having the ability to overcome these veils, we will not be able to truly connect and have that consciousness with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We do not want to be included, God forbid, in the verse of the Quran where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, نَسُوا اللَّهَ فَأَنْسَاهُمْ أَنفُسَهُمْ وَالْعِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ. So one of the first of these seven veils that I would like to discuss for tonight is carnal desires. Carnal desires, the ability to allow ourselves to indulge in what we call mujanabatul hawa, or to indulge in our own vainglory and hawa, in entertaining, in fulfilling our illegal, you know, or illegitimate, as they say, kind of desires. Because if you look at desires, without a doubt, by default, you know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created you as part of your innate nature with that kind of desires. However, having said that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also said that in order to fulfill and vent these desires, you need to vent them and you need to fulfill them through halal means and halal ways, right? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in His infinite wisdom, when He placed these desires in you, He knew that you need to vent these desires. But He programmed you also in such a way and provided you with means and with legislations to allow you to fulfill these desires in a halal way. Take this example. Let's say hypothetically, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not provide the means for venting these desires in a lawful and allowable way, then that law would be regulative or restrictive? What would you think it would be? Restrictive. Restrictive. Why? Because He puts something in you and then He says you cannot vent it. You can't exercise it. You can't get it out of your system. But in Islam, anything that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you in terms of laws, it is of a regulative nature, not of a restrictive nature. Example, let's say you go hypothetically on a Da'ir al-Rabi', the fourth ring road. You have something called that, right? The fourth ring road. Imagine if you drive on the fourth ring road and then all of a sudden you find that there are no exits. There are no exits. Do you call that road based on traffic law regulative or restrictive? Restrictive, because there's no exits. You're stuck. You know, you can't make a U-turn until you get to Khafji, for example. Musiba. Absolute disaster, right? But if you had exits along the way, then you know that the traffic authority in this country has made it easy for you to manage your driving capabilities and abilities, right? And then driving becomes something that is regulative. You are at ease with it, right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has put in you a similar system where he said, there are these desires, but you can vent them in a halal way. For example, your desires towards intimacy. He says to you, don't commit an act of zina. Rather, I've given you other means to vent your intimacy. Go to marriage, right? Go to marriage. Don't touch certain kind of liquids. Don't go towards certain type of liquids or drinks, right? This drink is not allowed. And he names it, for example, khamr, let's say, for example. But alternatively, I've given you more than 10,000 types of drinks. What's wrong with mango juice, for example? Does it have to be? What's wrong with orange juice? What's wrong with, you know, watermelon juice? What's wrong with this and this and this and this and this? And does it have to be something that takes your sanity away? Does it have to be something that causes in the ultimate or penultimate result or outcome of drinking such a liquid that you become abusive, that you lose your family, that you begin to hate and scream and have anger issue and so on and so forth? And the list goes on and on and on and on. As a result of what? One thing. As a result of one thing. And this is a kind of, you know, like a measure that you can use, or a yardstick, if I may use this term, to see what is allowed and what is not allowed, and regulate your life accordingly. Regulate your life accordingly so that you lead a balanced life. You lead a balanced life like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said. For example, look what Imam Ali salawatullah wa salamuhu alayhi had to say in regard to this matter. He said, أوصيكم بمجانبة الهوى فإن الهوى يدعو إلى العمى وهو الضلال في الآخرة والدنيا. الله أكبر. It cannot get worse than that. The Imam says, I advise you, I counsel you to avoid desires, for passion invites to blindness, which is misguidance in this world and the hereafter. Right? If you allow yourself to become someone that allows himself to be under the yoke of his own desires, then that would lead you to blindness. You know why? Because you will never get enough. And you cannot stop at one thing once you allow yourself to indulge more and more into these desires. It's like the abyss. The more you go into it, the more you go down into it. The more you get implicated. The more you can't even reach the bottom of it, because you keep searching for more and more and more and more. And then you end up being blinded by your desires. You can never have enough of it. You know, one of these very famous rugby players. Do you know rugby, or just soccer or football? Rugby is famous. You know. His name is Sonny Bill Williams. Sonny Bill Williams. He's a Maori. You know what a Maori? A Maori are the inhabitants, the original people of New Zealand. Just like the Aboriginal, for example, in Australia. They are the native people of New Zealand. They're Maori. So he's a Maori who became a Muslim. Just recently he went and he performed Hajj. After he performed Hajj, you know what he said? He said, I used to indulge in every act of haram. I would not leave the discos and the clubs before 2 or 3 in the morning. Sometimes I would leave the club with the break of dawn. And now, after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have guided me to Islam, I start my day with the prayer of dawn. And I leave the mosque after I pray my dawn prayers. Subhanallah. Subhanallah. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to guide someone, He provides the means for him as long as he takes the initiative, right? You know what? Guidance does not come from Allah unless Allah decides himself with his infinite wisdom without an effort. Without an effort. Allah wants you to show genuine effort that you really want to reach Allah, and Allah will provide 1,000 means for you to reach him. Just like, for example, in, as I mentioned a few days ago in Surah Al-Kahf, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he speaks about this youth, Ahlul Kahf, what does he say? Does he say, I sent a battalion of Malaika with AK-47 and I told them to believe? Did he? يعني our concept of hidayah. For example, I'm sitting at home, اللهم اهديني في من هديت. What do you expect, يعني اللهم اهديني في من هديت? That some Malaika would come with a 9-inch magnum, put it to your head and say, get out and go to pray and we will follow you if you don't so we can shoot you. It doesn't happen, hidayah. This is a wrong concept of hidayah. This is a wrong concept of guidance. Allah wants you to voluntarily to reach him. Allah wants you without coercion. Allahu Akbar. Allah says, لا إكراه في الدين. قد تبين الرشد من الغي. فمن يكفر بالطاغوت ويؤمن بالله فقد استمسك بالعروة الوثقى لا انفصام لها. الله ولي الذين آمنوا يخرجهم من الظلمات إلى النور والذين كفروا أولياؤهم الطاغوت يخرجونهم من النور إلى الظلمات. سبحان الله. So what does he say about أهل الكهف? Look at the siyaq of Quran. Look at the chronology of the book of Allah. It speaks volumes. He said, إِنَّهُمْ فِتْيَةٌ آمَنُوا. So who took the first step? أحسنت رحم الله والده. What did we do to them as a result of them believing? فَزِدْنَاهُمْ هُدَى. We advanced them in guidance. الله أكبر. عطل الدنيا إلهم 309 سنوات. الله أكبر. That's why I always say in my lectures, deal with Allah and feel the difference. Wallah, deal with Allah once. We dealt with Marxism, we dealt with, you know, I don't know what system. We dealt with every system. We tried every system on earth. Ya akhi, try Allah once. You're not going to lose, right? Try Allah, try Ahlul Bayt. Salawatullah wa salamu alayhi. Try Muhammad wa Al Muhammad. Salawatullah wa salamuhu alayhim ajma'in. وين صلوات مش تعبانة اليوم شنو صلوات تعبانة هو صلوات على محمد وآل محمد. I'm used to people of Kuwait that when صلوات are recited it hits the roof bro. صلوا على محمد وآل محمد. So take the initiative. Take the first step. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَمَنْ يَتَّقِ اللَّهِ يَجْعَلْ لَهُ وَيَرْزُقْهُ وَمَنْ يَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى اللَّهِ فَهُوَ اللَّهُ أَكْبَرُ. What else do you want? You are under the patronage of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, under the protection of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's there for you. He's telling you, just come near me. Do the right thing and I will provide every possible means for you to remain within the fold of that faith. To remain protected from all sort of temptation. But take the first step. Take the first step. Avoid any temptation that leads you towards one end or the other. Right? Don't allow this to happen. And you know, sometimes we do that to ourselves. Because our concept of guidance, as I said earlier, is misconstrued. For example, I'll give you an example of how we sometimes misview or miscalculate the concept of hidayah and how Allah has given you free will to choose between right and wrong. Let's say a friend of yours come to your home at 6 in the morning with the break of dawn, knocks at your door and says, شرايك نطلع حداق. Say, oh, yalla, why not? Let's go fishing, bro. It's the best thing to do in Kuwait. So you leave everything, the wife, the children, the work and everything, and you run. The same guy comes the next day, he says, let's go to Salat al-Fajr. Wallah ta'aban. Shinu hana? Yani Allah, enten hadait lil-hadaq, man hadait lil-salah? Ajeeb wallah. وبعدين يقول لك, Allahumma hdini fi man hadait. Ma hajatik al-hidayah lil-bayt. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knocked at your door. Metaphorically, of course, I'm saying metaphorically. Allah is not a body. Metaphorically, the guidance came and knocked at your door. You rejected it willingly. Right? Willingly. You rejected it. What else do you want Allah to do for you? Subhanallah. Like that guy who got stuck on a branch, remember? The story I told you? Or did I say it here or somewhere else? You know, a guy got stuck on a branch on a mountain and he said, Ya Allah, save me. Ya Allah, save me. So he sent him a chopper. They dangled a you know those ropes with the steps. He said, no, I want Allah to save me. عجيب هذا والله العظيم. So the chopper went, fell to his death. Day of judgment came. He said, Ya Allah, you said, you know, depend on me and I'll come to your rescue. And I asked you, he said, what do you want? I sent you the chopper. What else do you want? You want me to come to you in person? Ajeeb. Allah sends hidayahs in so many amazing ways. And we reject it. We turn it away from ourselves. And then we complain when things go wrong. Allah, Allah, Allah loves you so much that He appeals to you. Appeals to you. What else can a human being ask from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying to this human being, what else do you want other than me forgiving all your sins? What else do you want?
What else?
Like we said yesterday, قُلْ يَا عِبَادِيَ الَّذِينَ أَسْرَفُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ لَا تَقْنَطُوا مِنْ رَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبَ جَمِيعَ مو 50%, مو 70%, مو 80%, مو 90%, مو 99%. جَمِيعَ all your sins. All your sins. How amazing is that God? Right? Imagine if you teach your children this concept about God, the God of positiveness, right? Rather than inculcating in their mind the God that is always angry, the God is fuming, the God that wants to kill them, the God wants to barbecue them, the God wants to put them in the tandoor, the God wants to make out of them tandoori chicken. Allah has a kitchen. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is appealing to you with absolute wisdom and love reaching out to you. I have never seen a loving God like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wallah al-azim. Oh, this is through experience. Things that we faced and you think that these knots are so tight that they're not going to be unknotted. All of a sudden you wake up the next morning and the biggest problem you were worried about, it got unknotted in front of your very eyes. In front of your very eyes. But we people, we are sometimes people that despair from the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And one of the gravest thing to do in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is in fact to despair from the mercy of Allah. وَلَا يَيْأَسْ مِنْ رَوْحِ اللَّهِ إِلَّا الْقَوْمُ الْكَافِرُونَ Imam Ali says, إِنَّكَ إِنْ أَطَعْتَ هَوَاكَ أَصَمَّكَ وَأَعْمَاكَ وَأَفْسَدَ مُنْقَلَبَكَ وَأَرْدَاكَ Allahu Akbar. Imam Ali said, if you yield towards your temptation, it will corrupt your heart. Your heart will become corrupt, you know. It will turn you deaf and mute and blind because you can't see anything else in front of you. You can't see anything. Imagine yourself, God forbid, sitting on a table gambling. Due to your engrossed nature, you are so totally immersed in what you're doing, you forget everything around you. You keep betting and losing, betting and losing, betting and losing, betting and losing, until this is a real story. Someone in the United States from our community, he bet on his house and his family. Wallah. And then you know what he did? In the end, he went and committed suicide because he lost everything. He betted on his home, his wife and his kids, and he ended up killing himself. Well, and you know what he did before he killed himself also? This is the sad part. He went and shot his family members first. Indulging in these kind of desires leads to these consequences. And you know, this rosy West that they want us to think they are the best democracy in the world and the most freedom in the world. You know what they do? You know what they do? This is at least from where I come from. The most ludicrous law under the sun. Gambling is allowed in Australia. Okay. And there are two features to gambling arenas. Do you know what they are? Ask psychologists. They'll tell you why. What are the two most features of a gambling parlor? Do you know? I'll tell you. No clocks, no windows. No clocks and no... Do you know why? So they never know what time it is. They lose track of time. So if he comes into the gambling parlor at 4 o'clock, no clocks, no windows, leaves the next morning or the next afternoon at 4 o'clock or 5 o'clock, he thinks he stayed there for an hour. It's all to do with psychology. That's not the worst part. That's the worst part. So he goes in from one entry and the exit is from another place. So the exit and entry are not in the same place. The exit, now this is the most ludicrous thing, the most unbelievable thing. As he leaves, he's got banners or leaflets like this one, which has the QR code. You know what the leaflet reads? It's funny. Well, I can't hold myself, but they said, if you have a problem with gambling, we can give you counseling. Are you serious? Are you really serious? You people produce vaccines and immunization against the worst disease. You have the most advanced system for combating cancer or kidney problems or I don't know what. And then you put such a stupid leaflet. If you have a problem with, why did you allow it in the first place? And you know what? The caption under, we will provide you counseling. And then the note under, you know, the it's free of charge. Maybe you already emptied all his pockets. Where is he going to give you money for counseling or therapy anymore? Ajeeb. Wallah al-azeem. Allah Allah. It's unbelievable. And we cry that we want this kind of freedom. We cry and we plead that this is the kind of free. I want to enjoy life. Enjoy life and end up with what? With what? Look at all these celebrities that you know. All of them. Most of them end up doing what to themselves? Two things. Either they shoot up, kill themselves, or they die out of what? Depression, right? What's the name of this guy who made the whole world laugh and smile? Huh? No, I'm قديم هذا وين انت مال سبعينات تمام. No. Robin Williams. You know what he said in his last moment before he died? He said, I entertained the whole world when I was left alone in my apartments, wishing I would have someone to converse with, someone to talk to. These were his last words, someone to talk to. When you take God out of your equation, then surely you're going to be in the depression. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَنْ أَعْرَضَ عَنْ ذِكْرِي فَإِنَّ لَهُ مَعِيشَةً ضَنْكًا ونحشره يوم القيامة أعمى قال ربي لما حشرتني أعمى وقد كنت بصيرا قال كذلك أتتك آياتنا فنسيتها وكذلك اليوم تنسى. الله أكبر. Allah didn't enforce this on him. This guy, had he had God in him in his life, he would have communicated with God. He would have spoken to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala like you speak to your intimate friend. You know, we have such a wealth of resources that we can turn to in terms of depression, in terms of anxiety, in terms of anger, in terms of feeling lonely, but we don't, you know, we don't extrapolate them. We don't use them. I remember a guy, a Sayyid here from Kuwait, by the way, I don't want to mention the name. He mentioned this story. I heard it myself from him directly. He said one day he was in the dhariha of Imam Hussein, salawatullah alayhi, in the shrine of Imam Hussein. All of a sudden he saw an old man facing the dhariha, akramakumullah, with his legs towards the dhariha of Imam Hussein. But his legs are so swollen and so, you know, that they cut, you know, the flesh is actually cut, you know. And he's mumbling, he's saying few words. So this Sayyid said, you know what? It's so disrespectful for this old man to sit in that manner. So I wanted to go and, you know, just give him a piece of advice. He said, as I approached him, I heard him saying these following words. You know, as he was coming, he's coming from the back. He's saying to Imam Hussein, he's talking to him. He says, Assalamu alaikum Abu Ali. ترى لا تنساني يوم القيامة أنا جيتك من البصرة مشيا على الأقدام لا تنساني يوم القيامة. This Sayyid goal, I took a few steps back. I felt ashamed. This man is talking to his beloved. Who am I to come and interrupt his discussion? Allahu Akbar. Who am I to come and disrupt his intimate talk with the love of his life? Imam Hussein, salawatullah. This guy taught me adab. Taught me mannerism, how to speak to the imams. He's speaking to him as if he was his own friend. And this is how our imams want you to approach them, right? That's how they want you to approach. Don't approach them on the basis of just asking Allah through them for hajat, for needs, you know? Because Allah will answer you somehow. If you believe in their sanctity and in their holiness and in their infallibility and in their closeness to Allah, based on that, because Allah honored them and Allah made them as infallible guides to humanity, if you ask Allah through them, Allah inshallah will not turn you back. Will not turn you back, right? But look at the way you communicate with them and talk to them. The first thing you must acknowledge their presence and their rights on you. One of our maraja at Taqleed, once a group of people were visiting him. You know him, he's famous in Najaf. His name Ayatollah Bashir Najafi. A group of people went to visit him. So he's talking to them. So the first thing he asked them, when you come from your countries and you do ziyarah to Imam Hussein, what is the first thing you tell him? They said, we ask him for hajat. We ask him for our needs through Allah. Ya Allah, for the sake of Imam Hussein, give me a son. Ya Allah, for the sake of Imam Hussein, I want a house. Ya Allah, for the sake of Imam Hussein, I want wealth. Ya Allah, for the... You know, the marja, this Ayatollah, you know, Ayatollah Bashir, when he talks, he talks. You know, he's like Prophet Musa. You know, he gets so, you know, into it. You know, he's like, so into it. He said, shame on you. Huh? You know, the leader of the caravan, the group, he said, Mawlana, you teach us to say this. He said, we teach you to say this, yes. But the first thing you should say to your imam, first and foremost, before you ask anything, you tell him, Ya laytana kunna ma'akum. Fanafuza fawzan azim. This is what you should say to your imam first. Pledge your allegiance to him. Because his grandson is waiting for that oath of allegiance. Al-Imam Al-Hujjat ibn al-Hasan salawatullah wa salamah. Right? Pledge that allegiance to him so that you would know that that your heart is in the right place. Subhanallah. Taf alayna al-waqt wa nisayna al-majlis. Wal-yom majlis Abu Fadl al-Abbas salamullah alayhi. Ma'alash, adhuruna al-yom min waqtkum shway, yani, aw kada. Ala kulli al-ahwal. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala provides us with the means to take these guides as role models. One of these guides, obviously, without a doubt, is Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas, salawatullah wa salamu alayhi. In one of the you know, the, subhanallah, in one of the, sallu ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. In the ziyarah of Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas, salamullah alayhi, it's amazing how the status and the stature, the high lofty position that Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas had reached on account of what he had offered in protection for Islam, which was represented and incarnated and personified in the person of his brother al-Imam al-Husayn salawatullah wa salam. In the ziyarah we said, Ashhadu. لقد نصحت لله ولرسوله ولأخيك فنعم الأخ المواسي فلعن الله أمة قتلتك ولعن الله أمة ظلمتك. And listen to this. ولعن الله أمة استحلت منك المحارم وانتهكت في قتلك حرمة ال... طيب. The sanctity of Islam. Here the ziyarah says, and may Allah curse those who upon killing you have violated the sanctity of Islam. Have violated the sanctity of Islam. طب you and I know that the sanctity of Islam can only be violated on account of two things only. The killing of a prophet or the killing of an infallible imam. Right? The killing of a marja or the death of a marja, does it include intihak hurmatul Islam? No, it doesn't. How is it in the case of Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas? It says, and on account of you, the sanctity of Islam was violated. This is highlighted in what Imam al-Sajjad said. You want to understand it? Look what Imam al-Sajjad said. Rahimallahu ammi al-Abbas. ابن علي فلقد آثر وأبلى وفدى أخاه بنفسه حتى قطعت يداه فأبدله الله بجناحين ليطير بهما مع الملائكة في الجنة كما جعل لجعفر بن أبي طالب وإن للعباس عند الله تبارك وتعالى منزلة يغبطه عليها جميع الشهداء يوم القيامة. الله أكبر. The narrator says, when there was no one left with Imam Hussein except his brother Al-Abbas, he came to seek and solicit permission from his brother to go and fight. Imam Hussein did not give this permission. Rather, he cried and said, oh, my brother, you are the flag bearer of my army and my backbone. Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas said, قَدْ ضَاقَ صَدْرِي وَسَئِمْتُ الْحَيَاةِ وَأُرِيدُ أَنْ أَطْلُبَ ثَارِي مِنْ هَؤُلَاءِ. Imam Hussein then said to him, then go and fetch water for the children of the camp. The narrator of the incident says, Al-Abbas went, began to admonish them and rebuke them. They refused his counsel. He came back to Imam Hussein, saying to him, they refused every appeal. Then Ash-Shamir cried out loudly, يا ابن أبي تراب لو كان وجه الأرض كله ماء وهو تحت أيدينا لما سقيناكم منه قطرة. Then Shimmer cried out, O son of Abu Turab, if the whole earth was water and it was under our control, we would not have given you an atom or a drop of it. Imam Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas went back to the tent to fetch his water bag. He heard all the children crying in the following terminology, Al-Atash, Al-Atayaya. Then he proceeded or wanted to proceed towards the battlefield or into the Mashra'a, the waterway of the Euphrates. His sister Zainab held him from his clothes and she said with a very weak voice, أخي أبا الفضل الوداع الوداع يا نور عيني. He mounted his horse, took his water bag, and he entered the Mashra'a after unveiling the 4,000 warriors who were appointed to protect the path to the waterway. They began throwing arrows at him until his back was like an echidna. When he reached the waterway, he took a handful and looked at it. He remembered the thirst of his brother Imam Hussein. He threw the water away and he began to say, Ya nafsu min ba'd al-Husayni huni wa ba'dahu la kunti an takuni هذا حسين وارد المنون وتشربين بارد المعين. Then he threw the water away, he filled his water bag and came out. Umar ibn Sa'd screamed out, block his way, for by Allah, if the water reaches the camp, you will have no chance to fight against Hussein. Hussein and his brother Abu al-Fahd. When he saw what they were doing, he said to them, Inni ana al-Abbas aghdu bis-siqa wa la akhafu al-maut yawm al-multaqa. They threw him again with the arrows until his back was like an echidna again. Then Zayd ibn Warqa, with the help of Hakim ibn Tufail, hid behind a tree. When Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas passed, they severed his right arm or hand. He began to recite, Wallahi in qata'tum yamini إني أحامي أبدا عن ديني وعن إمام صادق اليقين نجل النبي الطاهر الأمين. He fought so vigorously until he stopped because of the blood that came out of his body. At that moment he was still riding his horse. Hakim ibn Tufail hid behind another tree. When Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas passed by him, he severed his left hand. He said loudly, Ya nafs la takhshay min al-kuffar wa abshiri bi rahmat al-jabbar. Qad qata'u bi baghyihim yasari fa aslihim ya rabbi harra an-nar. And when that happened, he has no more hands. He took the water bag with his teeth. All his concern was to bring the water to the camp and to the children of the camp, if in particular to Sukaina, his darling niece. And then they watered him again with all the arrows. Ahwa Abbasa, one of these arrows, Ya'uzu alaykum ya mu'minin, landed in the water bag. It spilt all the water. Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas remained perplexed. Where is he gonna go? No hand, his back full of arrows. The water bag has been affected. While he was like that on the back of his horse, Ya'uzu alaykum ya mu'minin, an arrow landed in his chest, another arrow landed in his right eye. Another person from Bani Tamim, from the tribe of Tamim, hit him with a pole on his head. Listen to these brothers and sisters. Normally, when a warrior falls from his horse, how does he receive the land? How does he receive the ground? He received the ground with his hand, right? But Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas had no hands. Allahu Akbar. How did he fall, salamullah alayhi, to the ground? And then he cried out from the loudest of his voice, Alayka minni salam ya Aba Abdullah, adrikni ya akhi. The narrator says Imam Hussein rushed to him. He found him fighting for his life. He opened his eyes. He couldn't open his eyes because the blood was stuck on it. Imam Hussein began to treat it because he wanted to bid him farewell. When he saw him, he said, Oh my brother, I have two requests. Don't take me back to the tent. Don't make me back and put me in the tents of the shuhada. Why, my brother, I shouldn't? He said, Because I promised Sakina. Allahu Akbar. I promised Sakina with water, and the second part is I want to remain where I am. Ya khoi ya Hussein, khallin bmichani, igilla leish ya zahrat zamani. He says, Why do you want me to leave you there? He says, I promised. سكينة to bring her water. أجركم الله يا مؤمنين. والإمام حسين is there at his brother's hand. أبو الفضل العباس took a long breath and his soul departed his body. رحم الله من نادى وعباسا وأخا. Then Imam Hussein, says the narrator, went back towards the tent. Sayyida Zainab came out. She said, oh Abu Abdullah, I see you coming back alone. رجعت وحيدا فريدا. أين ابن والدي؟ أين أخي العباس؟ One narration says he never replied. Rather, he went to the tent of Abu al-Fam. It was Arab custom that when a warrior died, they put his tent down. Imam Hussein took to the pole of the tent, pulled it out. The whole tent fell apart. رحم الله من نادى وعباسا. إنا لله وإنا إليه راجعون. وسيعلم الذين ظلموا أي منقلب ينقلبون. ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم. Five times from the bottom of your hearts for those who have hajat, for those who have asked us to pray for them, for those who are inflicted in one way or another. Let's join together and pray for them and pray for yourself in the course of things as well. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Amman yujibu al-muttarra idha da'a wa yakshifu al-su. Amman yujibu أمن يجيب المضطر إذا دعاه ويكشف السوء. أمن يجيب المضطر إذا دعاه ويكشف السوء. Last one. أمن يجيب المضطر إذا دعاه ويكشف السوء. بحق محمد وآل محمد وبحرمة الفاتحة مع الصلوات. الله الله الله.